So we can't categorize the Bangladesh as their basically secular country. The other thing is there are atrocities. Hello everyone, welcome to Plutus IAS. I am CA Sonali Chandan. We are starting daily news analysis. Today is 8th August 2024 and this has been a significant date in our history because on the same day Gandhiji has started Quit India movement. Now we are basically independent country because of that movement. 8th August 2024, we are starting daily news analysis. So our topics to be covered in this video will be, one, first is we will discuss the Bangladesh scenario, whatever is happening there recently, and then Vinesh Fogart's disqualification from the Paris Olympics. Then we will move to long-term capital gains amendment. We will discuss what it is, and then further we will discuss what is short-term or long-term capital gain. Thereafter we will see what is the amendment there, and then the PAMLA Act amendment and the Supreme Court review judgment here. Prevention of Money Laundering Act, we will discuss firstly what is money laundering, and then we will see the relevant examples for the exams can be used in the civil services mains, and then we will see some of the topic relevant for the prelims. In this video we will try to remain basically relevant to the exam. We will see how you can use the same information in the mains, and then how it can help you to solve the MCQ of the prelims. Now, the first newspaper article, it says extra 100 grams crushes the basically Vinesh Fogart's gold medal goal. It basically, she was playing in the 50 kg category, but on the day of the finals, she was 100 grams above this 150 kg goal. Now she has moved to the CAS. This is a court of arbitration for the sports to get the demand of joint silver medal, because in the disqualification she is not eligible for any of the medal. She is not eligible for even silver medal. So we have discussed what is the basically reason for the disqualification and what will be the consequences that she will not be eligible for the silver medal. And in the prelims, basically UPSC, CSE, all those sports questions were not being asked till 2021. But after that, there has been few of the questions that are being asked specifically on the sports. So they can ask Paris Olympiacs, and who was the opponent of her, Sarah Hildebrandt. She belonged to the US. Now she will be the contender for the gold medal. Now you have to also see what is the court for the appeal in the sports. This is a court of arbitration for the sports. And if we see the historical context, Fogart was basically first Indian woman wrestler jo ke Olympics final tak reach ki hai, but she has lost the chance for the gold medal. Now we have seen the exam relevance for the prelims. It can be asked in the sports questions. Next article on the Bangladesh. There are numerous articles in tourist newspaper and it was in news from so many days. Firstly, we will see what is happening in the Bangladesh so that we can be able to understand the news. First is quota system. Basically, there was a quota system in the Bangladesh that give around 30% reservation to the freedom fighters. But in January 2024, the reform movement has started against this quota system. Later on, court has reduced this quota to 5% only, but still the movement continues, and later on this quota reform movement converted into anti-government movement, and the students movement demanded the resignation of the Sheikh Hasina, and they want to bring reforms in the Bangladesh. And this movement converted into the hostile protest later led to the resignation of the Sheikh Hasina. What led to the fall of the Sheikh Hasina? We have discussed the issue in brief. What was the quota system in the Bangladesh, and later it led to the basically anti-government movement, and she was ruling the Bangladesh since 2009. Now, who will basically replace Mohammad Yunus is going to take the oath belonging to the BNP, Bangladesh Nationalist Party. He's landing from the Dubai, and he's going to take oath today at 8 p.m. Who is Mohammad Yunus? This is important. He has contributed to the microfinance. And in GS3 mains, they have asked how the microfinance act as a anti-poverty vaccine. So again, as due to the Mohammad Yunus, microfinance is in the news, and this question can be repeated in GS3. And microfinance is basically giving the small loans or small amount of support to the poor people so that they can come out of the poverty. For example, if the loan is given to some street vendor for only 10,000, 20,000, basically the amount up to 3 lakhs, it's considered as a microfinance. It also includes the basically micro insurance as well. So we have seen what is the contribution of the Mohammad Yunus to the world. And the other news says India pulls out the non-essential staff and the family of the diplomats from the Dhaka. And there has been other operations as well that has been conducted by the India to bring their Indians back. For example, we have conducted the Operation Ganga to bring our students from the Ukraine. We have conducted the basically missions from the Maldives or the Sri Lanka, and now the operation is for the Bangladesh. There could be a question on the match the following. To give you the operation, there has been Operation Dost for the helping the people in the Turkey during the earthquake. So the question could be in the match the following format to ask about the operations. Now India is conducting this basically movement to bring his people back from the Bangladesh. Now this article says the leader lost the touch with Bangladesh. Basically, Sheikh Hasina has resigned recently and she fled to the India, and she is asking for the basically safe shelter from the UK, but she has been denied this shelter. And now what will be the impact of this scenario on India? We have to understand this. In GS2, this lever says what are the bilateral relations. So basically bilateral relations between the countries can be asked. And second thing, there could be the question on the regional grouping. Like for example, India and Bangladesh belongs to the SAARC group and BIMSTEC. And in fact, there is newspaper articles on the BIMSTEC FTA, Free Trade Agreement. You need to see the South Asian region is having just 5% trade, around 5%, and in this number has reduced due to the recent crisis that has been seen in the South Asian region, the neighborhood region of India. So we have seen GS2 bilateral relations of the regional groupings can be asked as such. You have to write the significance of these, and then you have to write about the issues, then you should prepare the way forward. Here the issues, in this issues, you have to give the reference of the Bangladesh crisis. So basically, if you even keep on reading the various newspaper articles relating to the whatever happened in the Bangladesh, this is not going to help you in the mains at least. Because in this, you have to just give reference to the Bangladesh crisis as an example maybe, or you can mention as an issue and challenges. So in this video, we will discuss how the newspaper articles are being used in the mains. But in the interview, of course, they can ask you about the whole scenario. And in this, you have understood bilateral relations issues can be mentioned, SAARC or BIMSTEC related questions can be made. And now, whenever the question comes relating to any of the international organization or the bilateral relations, you have to mention the impact or significance in the terms of the PESEL format. For example, you should mention the social impact, political, economic. Here you can use the word as geopolitical. Economic, maybe you can mention about the infrastructure, international groupings. Maybe here in the social, you have to see in the Bangladesh. In fact, there is a basically topic in the GS2 syllabus. This asks about the constitutional comparison. If we see in India, there is a secularism, but in Bangladesh, they have declared the Islam as the official religion. Now GS1 asks about the secularism. They have already asked what is the difference between the Indian secularism and Western secularism. You have to prepare that. And the other one thing is, what is the difference between India and Bangladesh? They have declared one religion as their official religion. So we can't categorize the Bangladesh as their basically secular country. The other thing is, there are atrocities on the minority section in the Bangladesh. If there are atrocities on the minority sections, who is minority there? Obviously, Hindus and Christianity. So they are facing the atrocities. This can have impact on basically Indian secularism. There could be basically some contention between Hindu and Muslims in India as well. And if you are writing any GS1 secularism question, you can mention the issues here. How Indian government is facing difficulties or challenges to maintain the secularism in India. You can mention this example. As the atrocities on the minorities in the neighborhood region is seen, there has been impact on the India as well. Then you have to mention the geopolitical impact. For example, Chinese influence can increase in Bangladesh because there is a port, Mongla port in Bangladesh. Earlier it was to be developed by China, but there was a debate that it might be given to the Bangladesh, might be given to the India. So this will have an impact. So Chinese influence can increase. In fact, SAARC or BIMSTEC regional groupings might become dysfunctional. You can mention all this, and in fact you can think of the Pakistan. If you will see the region of Bangladesh, and in fact Bangladesh is East Pakistan. So Pakistan impact can increase on the Bangladesh. Other impact could be, Bangladesh could become another Iran, where political instability has been seen. And in fact, when there is a instability in the neighborhood region, obviously you can't grow. Atal Bajpayee has said, you can change your friends, obviously, but you can't change your neighbors. That's why geography is more important than the history. He said, you can change your history, but you can't change your geography. So geographical location of the Bangladesh has been a challenge for the India. So Chinese influence can increase. Pakistan could come more nearer to the Bangladesh. And in fact, terror groups can basically increase in the Bangladesh. It has the links between the organized crime. It can be mentioned in the GS3 internal security topic as well. Then comes the infrastructure. If you will see this map, there is a Agartala-Akura rail link. It is basically linking the Akura of the Bangladesh to the Agartala of the India. It is reducing the distance between the India and Bangladesh, and it is linking with the Northeast region. So For the Northeast region development, there is a need of infrastructure and we have to collaborate with the Bangladesh. You could see the location of the Tripura. Tripura is just between the Bangladesh. So it has basically impact on Northeast region. Already there has been refugee crisis in Assam due to the Bangladesh. Same influence can be seen in the Tripura. You can see the location of Tripura here. So it could impact the Northeastern stability. Already the influence on the Assam, this refugee crisis can multiply. Already there is an NRC issue. Now we have seen infrastructure problem. In fact, India has basically invested a lot in this infrastructure. We have already basically built the Indian side of rail link, but the pending is of the Bangladesh side. So our money is in the risk, our other investments are on high risk. Then comes a trade. If we see Indian pomegranate or the fruits or vegetables, trade has been with the Bangladesh, and in fact other traders like basically textile company traders, they used to have factories in the Bangladesh. They have already sent their raw materials there. There could be a problem of the basically payment issue and it could convert into the NPA. Non-performing asset issues in the banking sector. So it has a basically multiplier impact on India. This way you have to analyze every news. Try to see how will you basically mention in the exam. So we have seen the exam relevance in the GS2. It can ask about the bilateral relations or the regional groupings like SAARC or SAFTA or BIMSTEC. Or in fact, you have to also mention the potential FTA. FTA between the Bangladesh or India, this is in risk because there has been basically discussions between the Indian government and the Sheikh Hasina government for the FTA, but this will be on the hold, and there has been a good trade relations between the Indian government and the Bangladesh government. Recently in the past, Indian Prime Minister have said there is a Sonali Adhyay between the India and Bangladesh. It means there is a golden relationship between the both the countries, but this will be impacted due to this issue, and then it can be asked in the GS3 as the border management issues, because Bangladesh is there. There you have, you can use this as an example. And in the basically GS3, organized crime can increase. There also you can use this example. Now the other topic comes, this is a long-term capital gain. There is basically amendment has been brought to the long-term capital gain tax, and but we have to understand what is long-term capital gains. In the recent budget, government has removed the basically indexation, and the rate has increased from the 10% to 12.5%. So this was in news, but now the investors has been given the option, either you can pay the tax on 20% with indexation or 12.5% without indexation. So this is news, but you have to first understand what is capital gain. Like for example, if you sell any capital asset, then on this you get the capital gain. For example, you are selling your property, and in fact in the prelims they have asked what is capital gain. It was asked long back, they can go in more depth and it is in news, so it can be asked. So capital asset, if it is sold, then the capital gain comes. For example, you are selling your property at 10 lakh and you have bought it for only 2 lakhs. So basically, we are paying the taxes on the profit. You have to pay the tax on 8 lakh. This is capital gain. If the capital asset is sold, then on the profit, you have to pay the capital gains tax. It is further divided into the long term and the short term. Like government can specify, if you hold any asset for 1 year, like for example, you are selling your asset within 8 months, then it could be categorized into the short term. If you have sold that asset after 1 year, then it will be categorized as the long term capital gain. So we have understood what is capital gain. Then we have categorized them further into the short term and the long term. Now the position comes, what is indexation then? So I have said, you have purchased that property for the 2 lakh in 2010 maybe, and you have sold this in 2024 into the 10 lakh. We have calculated the profit of 10 lakh minus 2 lakh is equal to 8 lakh. But in the indexation, what we do is make this amount to the equivalent to the 2024. So what we do is take the index of 2024 index, assuming it to be 200, and here we divide it by the 2010 index. It could be 100. So you can basically divide and multiply with this. What amount comes is the 4 lakh. So what we are doing is making the amount of 2010 equivalent to 2024, assuming some interest could be earned on the 2 lakhs if you have not invested in the same property. So here the amount comes up 4 lakh. So with the indexation, you have to pay the taxes on 10 lakh minus 4 lakh. Here amounts comes the 6 lakh. But if we see the amount without indexation, then you have to take 10 lakh minus 2 lakh, amount comes the 8 lakh. So you will be paying the more tax on 2 lakh. The difference will be 2 lakh. So there is a benefit of the indexation, of course, if there is a long term. But government has given to the option, if you want to pay the tax for 12.5%, then you have to pay without indexation. So hopefully you have understood what is capital gain and what is basically long-term capital gain. And then you have understood what is indexation. Indexation is basically increasing the amount of cost of acquisition. You have acquired this property for the 2 lakh, but we have increased it to the 4 lakh. You are making the cost of acquisition compatible to the current year. So this way we could reduce our capital gain. Why this kind of basically provisions is being brought? Obviously in the mains, they will ask you what is the significance of the less long-term capital gain. Why the capital gain is being charged? Obviously capital gain gives the revenue to the government. Revenue to the government, it comes into the revenue receipt. It is important for the revenue budget. Now, they have already asked what is the difference between the capital budget and the revenue budget. So you have understood it will come to the revenue receipts. It can be asked in the prelims. Then the other part is less capital gain. What did it does actually? It boosts investment. Now you could make a chart. If something boosts the investment, it will obviously create the employment. Employment can be converted into the more income or the more GDP. So growth can be boosted with the less capital gain. it is acting on the basically supply side of economics, where we are basically charging less tax on the investment, so there will be a more investment to boost the economy. Next, the topic comes palm law. This is prevention of money laundering act. But firstly, you have to understand what is money laundering. Before that, just see the relevance in the exam. In GS3, it is asking about the organized crime, and money laundering is one of the organized crime. Firstly, understand what is money laundering. Money laundering is basically proceeds of crime. This crime could be maybe drug trafficking, arms trafficking, human trafficking, any of the crime. If you are holding the proceeds of that crime, then you are involved in the money laundering. Then the next provision is, if you are converting this proceeds of crime into the untainted property, it means you are involved in the money laundering. So what is untainted property? Tainted means daag lagi hui property. If you are converting into the clean property, that is without daag, clean property, proceeds of crime are being converted into the untainted property. How it can be done? Obviously, if we integrate that money into the financial system, like for example, if you get the 100 crores or 1000 crores of the proceeds from the crime, obviously you will not get that money from the bank, you will get this in the cash maybe. And how you can integrate? Maybe you can buy expensive high value assets, maybe ship can be bought, or maybe casinos are made with this money, or basically expensive properties are being bought, or the basically tax haven countries to which this money is being sent. So this way, proceeds of crime are converted into the untainted property, integrated into the financial system. What are the steps to be taken for this money laundering? Firstly, you place that money into the system and do through the layering, like making multiple wire transfers. Like basically, if you get the 100 crores, instead of basically depositing this money to one single account, you deposit to the 100 accounts. So in each account, just 1 crore is being deposited. This way you make the wire transfer, then this money is being integrated to the financial system. These are the three steps that are conducted in the money laundering. So we have understood what is money laundering. You have understood what are the steps in the money laundering. But this money laundering, to investigate this system, one body is being made, that is Enforcement Directorate. Enforcement Directorate has been given powers in the Palm Law Act to tackle this problem. Now in the recent, the amendment, 2022 amendment has been upheld by the Supreme Court judgment in the Vijay Madan Lal Chaudhary versus Union of India. Now we have to see what were those amendments that were upheld, because this has been in news, as Supreme Court is going to review this judgment. Under this, first section 50, it says to record statement on oath, as it has been given the power to record the statement from the person. As I have already told you, Enforcement Directorate has been given power under the Palm Law Act so that he can conduct the smooth investigation, he can record the statement from the person on the oath. He is acting like a court here. Now this amendment was challenged against the Article 20. As it says, there is a fundamental right against self-incrimination. For example, if you are being charged in the police case and he is basically beating you and forcing you to record and give some statement, and if that statement is used against you to work as an evidence, then it can't be done, because there is an Article 20 which says it is fundamental right against self-incrimination. But Supreme Court has said this statement is not being recorded from the accused who is being charged for the case, but it is recorded from the other person who could help in the investigation. So this way, this amendment has been upheld by the Supreme Court. Then there is an amendment in that section 45. It has brought twin bail conditions. So basically two conditions has to be met to get the bail. First amendment says there should be a reasonable ground that person is not guilty. But you have to see, there is another amendment that has reversed the burden of proof on the accused. So basically, if you have already charged a case of Pamla against an accused, he has to prove himself that he is not guilty, he is an innocent. But how it can be charged as a basically bail condition, how he can fulfill this? How a reasonable ground can be brought that a person is not guilty? The other condition is person won't commit any offense on the bail. He can fulfill this condition, obviously. He can basically commit that he will not basically commit any offense while on the bail. But he is not able to basically fulfill this condition. Due to this condition, the bail can't be get by accused. As the accused can't get the bail, it is against his right to prove his justice, to get the justice. It is against his right. And then the ED, Enforcement Directorate, has been not bound to give the copy of ECR, IR. So basically, this is an investigation report that is being prepared by the ED after all the investigation. He is not bound to give this copy. Now you have to see that the burden of proof is on the accused. He should have some basically charge sheet or file or the ECR to prove that he is innocent, he is not guilty. But this chance has been taken away by giving the unbridled powers to the ED. And the last power of search and seizure has been increased of the ED. This way you can say that there is unbridled powers to the ED. In GS2, if the question comes on the investigation system, if you have to mention about the issues there, then you can mention about the unbridled powers of the ED. But in GS3, for reducing the money laundering acts and to basically tackling this system, there is a need of strong Pamla Act. There you can mention there is a issues in the Pamla Act. This way you can use it. The other thing, this can be asked in the prelims as there is a review of the judgment. So let me show you newspaper cutting. It says Supreme Court posed the review of the Pamla ruling on the 28th August. So basically, Vijay Madan Lal judgment 2022 will be reviewed by the Supreme Court on the 28th August 28. Now you have to see whether the Constitution has given the power of reviewing the judgment to the Supreme Court. Yes, under Article 137, it grants the power to the Supreme Court to correct the grave errors that resulted in the miscarriage of the justice. So you have to remind this article, as in prelims, they could ask whether the Constitution gives the reviewing power to the Supreme Court or not. Now you can see Article 137, and if the specific question on this comes in mains, then you can use this example, and you can obviously write the positives and negatives, because reviewing judgment is required as there should be no miscarriage of justice. Then comes the example for the GS3. It says riots spread across the towns in the UK precipitated by the disinformation and racism. You can use this as an example in the GS3 where you want to say there could be a challenge, internal security challenge due to the disinformation or the racism. Or you can give the example, what are the challenges of the internal security or maybe what are the basically reasons for the mob violence? Already question on the mob violence have been asked. They could ask it again, and riots have been seen due to it. You can mention this as a reasons for the internal security or the mob violence, and there you can mention the example of UK. Now the last topic comes of the prelims. There has been news in the for the yen carry trade. This is an economic concept, and in fact in the prelims questions has been increased for the stock market. They have already asked the beta, money market, capital market, and this number is going to increase, because if we see the economic survey 2022 quotes that the individual as the retail investors has increased in the stock market. They have already asked why, whether the retail investors can invest in the basically government securities or not, they could participate in the open market operations or not. They have already asked it. So basically stock market concepts can be asked. Let's discuss yen carry trade. Firstly, I want to discuss investment. For example, if you want to buy some share or any property, obviously you need a money. Nobody is going to give you it for free. To invest in this share, property, or maybe any of the capital asset, you need money. You could go to the friend or bank to get that money. He is obviously not give you for free. They say, I will charge you 10%. Then you calculate the return on investment. If you see there is 10% return only on the investment, then what is the incentive for you to invest here, as you are going to pay 10% there and you will earn only 10%. The profit will be zero. But if you negotiate with them to get the lower interest rate, if you get the money for only 5% and you are getting the 10% on the investment, then there is a profit of 5%. Like for example, if you are investing 1 lakh only, then you are at the profit of 5,000 in this transaction. So we have understood, if you will get the borrowings at lower interest rate, then you could invest it further. So obviously loans can be used for the basically getting the home property, but investors are using this for the investment purpose, to gain some profit, to basically incur some capital gains. In this yen carry trade, what they are doing is getting the Japan's loan at a very lower interest rate, and they are investing in the some high return investments. This is in news because there is a US recession recently, and due to this there has been a dip in the Indian stock market as well. So there is a selling pressure on the basically stock market. That's why yen carry trade is in the news. I hope you have understood, getting the loan at a very low interest rate, then in investing in the some high return investments. This is the concept that can be asked in the prelims. I hope you have understood how the different examples or the newspaper articles to be used in the mains or the prelims. I hope this will help you. We will continue this. Thank you.